Please stand.
When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with Christ in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who great mercy gave us new birth into a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. The inheritance to which we are born is one that nothing can destroy or spoil or wither. Friends, I welcome you to this service of witness to the resurrection and celebration of life. The family is comforted by your presence here and looks forward to greeting you in Watchhorn Hall following our service. It's located at the other end of the building. So if you'll exit out of the side door, go to the end of the hall and turn right and follow that hallway down, you will find the family and refreshment. Let us turn our hearts and our minds to God as we call ourselves to worship. O come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us sing to the Lord, this is the God of our salvation.
Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving.
Let us sing to the Lord, this is the Lord, this is the Lord, this is the songs of praise.
Please be seated.
Please bow with me in prayer. Holy God, Creator and Redeemer, we adore you. All we have to do is look around to see your greatness. Creation shows us your wonderful work, your power and beauty in all things. You gave us birth. You know our needs before we ask. So show us now your grace, that as we face the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Holy God, we praise you. We know we're mortal. We know that every individual that is here someday will stand in your presence, and we will experience your radiance. The radiance that Betty already knows. Thank you for families that support one another, for friends that are as rich as family themselves. Thank you, Holy God, that there was not a time that Betty was alone. Family, friends, caregivers, all demonstrating their love in the way they were able to do so. I pray, Lord, that you would help us to believe where we have not seen, trusting you to lead us through our years. Praise and glory, honor and strength are yours. Your love is unrestrained. You are worthy of our love, of our adoration. So worship receive our worship and praise. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
My mother's voice in the last months of her life was not strong, but she could sing, and we sang a lot, and we sang songs from her favorite movies, and we sang Christmas carols when December came around, but she loved her hymns, and she knew them all by heart. We watched Reverend in the morning at the service. We didn't need a hymnal. She sang all of them. This is one of her favorites. If you wouldn't mind, I'll sing to her the first, and the choir and John, and we all together can sing the rest to her and for her. I'll do my best.
Sendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul.
Thank you.
good sounding congregation. Thank you very much for that. Friends, when we come into the holy presence of God, our own humanity is laid bare. When we stand in the living presence of truth, our own falsehood is revealed. People of God, let us acknowledge who we are and ask our ever-present God to forgive us. Let us pray together. Holy God, you see us as we are and know our inmost true thoughts. We confess that we are unworthy of your gracious care. We forget that all life comes from you, and that to you all life returns. We have not always sought or done your will. We have not lived as your grateful children, nor loved as Christ loved us. Apart from you, we are nothing. Only your grace can sustain us. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us, heal us, and make us whole. Set us free from our sin and restore us to the joy of your salvation, now and forever. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone, a new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen. Please be seated. Let us pray. Eternal God, your love for us is everlasting. You alone can turn the shadow of death into the brightness of the morning light. Help us turn to you with believing hearts. In the stillness of this hour, speak to us of eternal things, so that hearing the promises in Scripture, we may have hope and be lifted above our distress into the peace of your presence. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Reading from the Old Testament, from Psalm 23, invite your attention to the public reading of God's holy word. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Psalm 116:15. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Daniel 12:1-3. There shall be a time of trouble, such as never has been since there was a nation till that time. But at that time, your people shall be delivered. Everyone whose name shall be found written in the book. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the sky above, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever.
Thank you. A reading from the first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15, verses 50 to 57. I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with the immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
A reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command and with the voice of an archangel and the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words.
A reading from the Gospel according to John. Chapter 14, verses 1 through 3. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. I should have introduced myself before. Betty has two sons, as most of you know. I'm John. Well, you already know this, but you may not know it at this point in my life. I'm the younger of the two sons. Some would say far younger. I want to thank you all so much for being here to celebrate my mother's life. She was Betty to most of you. She was Betty Carroll to some. See it, Angela? Betty Carroll. She was BB to her family. She was Grandma BB to the caregivers. And she was Mom to me. I'm like my brother. The Bruces have a gene that we have to cry, so I apologize for that. She was the most amazing mom person, and I loved her so, so much. Loved her so much. Before I start and reflect on my mother just a bit, I want to say thank you to some people that have really been paramount to the last 6 months of her life. First, the doctors and the nurses and therapists at the communities in Oklahoma City who took care of her and gave her the time that we had. There was the first doctor we met. This was amazing. Bebe to us as a family. the first doctor who walked into the ICU at Mercy, her name was Dr. Bahar Malakuti, a dynamo of a woman. And everything made sense. Her name, Bahar, to her family and friends was Bibi. I knew then and there that she was going to be okay. I mean, in the care of that she was getting. And through her skills, I believe, we were given 6 months to tell my mom how much she was loved by the world. I also want to thank my sister-in-law, Joni, my brother's wife, better half, and Cheryl, I love you, but Joni, where would we be without Joni? Because Joni was the warrior, the leader who gathered all the resources we needed in the last 6 months to be there for us by her side as best we could. I want to say thank you to Aurora. Where's Aurora? Oh, my eyes, my age. Aurora Quesada, you're her best friend. You've been with the family and by her side and by my father's side for so long. You're an official Bruce family member. And I hope you know that and how much you're loved. The last I want to just say a word to, and this is maybe personal to how I felt through the last 6 months. The caregivers that were surrounding my mother in the last 6 months, or 3 months of her life as she came home, she wanted to be at her home. And I see Lillian. Is my eyes right, Lillian? She had 6 caregivers: Lillian, Pimmy, Joe, Helen, Io, Precious, and JoJo for a time, but JoJo left for her baby. What you did for her, and she was so close to you and knew the value of you to her care and her life and her comfort. And the peace you brought us, when you walked the door, Lillian, in particular, I felt calm. I knew it was gonna be okay when you were there. And you two would sit like friends in the evening and watch a movie together, or you'd talk and you'd say to her, I think you told me that you would laugh at the contestants on Family Feud and the dumb guesses they'd make. And you brought her comfort, and I can't tell you how much I appreciate you for that. Lillian's, is anybody else here? I don't think so. I can't see that far. But each of them brought, Lillian brought this friendship, and Joe brought calmness. We have morning coffees. And Kemi would come in and say, wakey, Grandma Bibi, the most beautiful grandma in the world. It's time to rise and shine. And my mom would say, yeah, do you want to get up? And she would say, not really. Because it was early, quite early in the morning when we. But I just want to thank you all for what you did for her and then what you did for us, to give us calm and comfort and rest. I would ask if you could, just to give, where would we be in life without the caregivers we have? And I'd like to say thank you to Lillian and to you. And I know the rest would be here if not for their continued care of the community of Oklahoma City, because I know they're out there doing that work. Okay, it's fitting that we talk about caregivers and when we talk about Bibi, because Bibi was, at her core, a caregiver. She lived in service of others, and Jay and I have talked about this a lot. She grew up in a family in Ardmore. Her mother and her grandmother lived in service every day of their lives to the church or to the community or to the families that they helped in life. And this little toddler, this little strawberry blonde toddler, Betty Carroll, grew up in that environment, guided by that. And she had that throughout her whole life. And if you knew her, you saw the things she did, and I won't recant her life of work, but it was impactful to this church, with the Spark program, to this neighborhood, with the Paseo revitalization, to just the world around her. My favorite story, as big as the things she did in life, my favorite story that stuck with me is that when she would take her car in to get serviced, she would bring the mechanics a famous chocolate sheet cake. And if you had her chocolate sheet cake, it was like giving away gold. And so she got service on her car because they knew Bibi's cake was gonna come. And I just think that's the way she lived. She lived with a smile, she lived with her heart on her sleeve, and just people knew that when she was there, they were gonna be okay, because that's the way my mom lived. And I knew this carried on, and I'll circle around to this. When we were gathered in the hospital in the ICU in the first 2 weeks, they basically had a rule of two people in the ICU, but they kind of waived that because as a family we gathered. Dr. Malakuti left. No, you guys are okay. Come on in. My daughter Hannah and my daughter Ashley were up here with me a minute ago with the readings. Hannah slipped away and got her recipe, which is like gold. And she made the chocolate sheet cake and brought it back to the nurse, the doctor at the ICU. And if that's not a nutshell for BB living on in the world, then I don't know what it is. 3 years ago, almost the day, I sat in this very spot during COVID to say goodbye to my father. Many weren't here because of the environment at the time. And I talked about, we have a very close family. My brother and I, everyone, but my brother and I and my mother and dad are like this. And I said at the time how much at that moment I was struck by the loss of my father, who was essentially my kind of identical twin in makeup and pudginess, some would argue, and in emotion and in love of music and art. My dad and I were similar, and Jay and my mom were kind of twins in their peace and their calmness and their stability and their strawberry hair. And yet, over the last 3 years, after I lost my father, my brother and I have reflected a lot on this. And I'm blessed for this. We both, of course, I didn't see it at the time, but now I see how much my mother crafted who the family is. And I think my dad, if he were here, I know that he would agree that she was the root of the Bruce Cheese. She was the well from which all of our strength came. What an amazing, amazing woman. So we have a saying in our family now that's carried on between the four of us, my daughter and Ashley and Hannah and Cheryl and I. We have a saying, and it's on our group chat, and it's on our words to each other. It's Bruce Strong. And that means we love it, and we love each other, and we're devoted to each other. That was our care. And even that word, even the way we thought about each other was a BB foundation. I do think that we ought to, from this day on, rename it, that we're BB Strong. The last thing she said to me, I live in Chicago, so I had to unfortunately be here a lot. And by the way, I should give thanks to my family, because when my mother had her stroke in June, I had to be away from you all a lot. And you didn't, there's no grief there, but I felt bad because by putting her first, absolute first in my thoughts, everything else came a distant second. It just happened. And I wasn't there as much as I would like to have been, but that's what we needed to do. But I appreciate you so much and love you so much for giving me that opportunity to spend that time with her. The last thing I saw, when I saw her the week before she passed on Sunday, the 10th, I left on Wednesday to go home to Chicago to gather some things. And I said to her, she didn't speak long words or long sentences. She could talk and speak, but it was short. Her strength wasn't able to carry long sentences. And I walked in and I said to her, I always said, good morning, Mom, it's gonna be a good day. And I said to her in the one morning, how do you feel today? And I this was so unusual, it may not sound unusual, but it was earth-shattering. She said, I'm gonna be all right. I'm gonna be all right. I'm gonna be all right. And I said, of course you are, you're BB Strong. And I realize now, she was telling me she's gonna be all right. She wanted me to be okay. She wanted me to know it was gonna be okay, that's the way she wired. The way she carried herself in those last days, I know she was uncomfortable, I know she was unhappy. It was the family first, and she always carried herself that way. And so she said, I'm gonna be all right, I'm gonna be all right. I left thinking, because she was physically, strong. 4 days later, she started to fail. And Joni, you called me and said, you want to talk to her? I said, yes. Yeah. Hi, Mom. She said, hello. I said, Mom, I'll be there soon. Better get back. And she said, I'll be here. She wanted me to know. And that's the thought that left me. At the time, I said, I think she wanted to protect the family in her passing. But what I want to relay to you I'll be here, is that she lives on. She lives on in the family who knew her, and her kindness and her smile and her red glasses. She lives on in the family and in my girls and their tolerance and their kindness. And she lives on in me because she taught me how to see the world and to live in the world. And that gives me peace. I do hope and want God to bless Betty Carol, Bebe, Grandma Bebe, and God bless my mom.
I'd like to echo John's thoughts. I'm very grateful that we are close. I don't take that for granted. Not every family is, and not every brothers are close as we are. I do take comfort, though, that whenever we're together in the crowd, John has to go to great lengths to say that he's the youngest, otherwise you couldn't tell. True yes. Enough. Okay. And like John, reflecting on 3 years ago, it just seemed like 3 short years ago that I was here in this pulpit for my father's service. As I said then, and I'll repeat now, I can think of many places I would rather be than here, and many things I'd rather be doing than standing before you to give a reflection now on my mother's life. But I know what the scriptures say in the book of Ecclesiastes, from chapter 7. A good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of birth. It is better to go to the house of mourning than to the house of feasting, for death is the destiny of everyone, and the living take it to heart. And sorrow is better than laughter, for a sad face is good for the heart. And so I say to myself, be of good cheer and play the man. For the good of this day, for the good of everyone gathered here as a witness to the resurrection and in celebration of my mother's life. So what I hope to do in this reflection is think about my mother's life in such a way that it makes it compelling and valuable for this occasion. My hope is really to measure up to a quote from Phillips Brooks, the man who wrote O Little Town of Bethlehem. He said, two values of a marked and well-depicted life appear. It is of value first because it is exceptional, and second because it is representative. Every life is at once like and unlike every other. Every good story of a life, therefore, sets before those who read or hear it something which is capable of imitation and something which is incapable of imitation. I think you'll find that true of my mother's life. It was at once both representative and capable of imitation and something in its own way, her own way, exceptional and incapable of imitation. I hope to show you this in a time of reflection by taking parts of two letters by the Apostle John and wrapping them around my mother and showing the representative as well as the exceptional in her way and the way she lived. I think it would be helpful if you would find your pew Bibles because I'll make reference to both John's second letter, which you'll find just near the end of the Bible, and also the companion letter, 3 John. As you're turning to 2 John, I'll just begin with a reading from 2 John. The elder to the elect lady and her children whom I love in truth, and not only I, but also all who know the truth, because of the truth that abides in us and will be with us forever. Grace and mercy and peace will be with us from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Father's Son, in truth and love. I rejoice greatly to find some of your children walking in the truth, just as we were commanded by the Father. And I ask you, dear lady, not as though I were writing to you a new commandment, but the one we have had from the beginning, that we love one another. And this is love, that we walk according to his commandments, referencing Christ. And this is the commandment, just as you've heard from the beginning, so you should walk in it. For many deceivers have gone out into the world, those who do not confess the coming of Jesus Christ in the flesh. Such a one is the deceiver and the antichrist. Watch yourselves so that you may not lose what we have worked for, but may win a full reward. Everyone who goes on ahead and does not abide in the teaching of Christ does not have God. But whoever abides in the teaching has both the Father and the Son, and will end there. That's the word of the Lord. This little letter by the Apostle John has encouraged me over the past 6 months, from the moment I learned that my mother suffered a massive stroke, well, really 2 strokes, because I see my mother all through this letter of 2 John. Beginning with the opening line, the elder to the elect lady. By elect, John means chosen of God. And if ever there was a chosen lady in my midst, it was my mother. Chosen by God for salvation through faith in Christ, and chosen for a very specific life in the home, in the church, and in the community. Look what John says about this chosen lady. She is loved by all who know the truth. Some of you are here today in support of our family, and we are very grateful for that. But most of you are here because you know my mother, and to know her is to love her. As far as I can tell, everyone who came in contact with my mother, from lifelong friends to recent caregivers, sensed something special about her, something lovely and lovable. And the more you got to know her, the more you loved her. Why? Because as John says in verse 2, grace and mercy and peace from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Father's Son, abided upon her and in her. And she showed grace and mercy and peace to those around her. My mother walked in the truth and the commandments of Christ. You know, the one that John says we had from the beginning, that we love one another. Now, I could go to the Apostle Paul's magnum opus statement in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 for the nature of Christian love, but let's stay with the Apostle John. How did John describe love? He described it in this way. It's following Jesus in sacrificial giving of ourselves to others. You see that in John's first letter, chapter 3, beginning in verse 14. He says, we know that we have passed from death to life because we love each other. And this is how we know what love is. He's going to describe it for us. Jesus Christ laid down his life, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech alone, but also with actions and in truth. My mother excelled in loving others in just that way, as John described it. Let's quickly reflect on her life and see if it's not so. The elect lady in John's letter was known for hospitality. So was my mother. Betty Bruce showed great hospitality over the years, opening her home to guests for meals and parties, and welcoming friends to stay in her home. But her hospitality was just one facet of her life of love and service. Well into her 80s, she was still delivering mobile meals to shut-ins, and she was tutoring children. She called them her spark kids for the work that she founded and began, the spark program here at this church. Those kids who needed a little love and someone to help them learn to read, she was there. I can just picture her sitting by a young child and just reading and helping that child learn to read, but doing it in love. Think of those kids and those shut-ins as mom giving a refreshing drink of cool water to the least of these. And in doing so, she was doing it to Christ. I can't help but think of Jesus' words from Matthew 25. They're words that he will say in the future as king from his throne. He will say, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me." I'm sure if we had time, you could gather here today, could give me so many more examples of how my mother loved and served you and others. Truly, I would like to hear every story, because I was only able to see a part of the ways that she loved and served you in this church and in other venues. I only know what I have witnessed, but I have seen much of her ways among you and also among her family, whom she loved dearly in words and in actions, her sons, her daughters-in-law, grandchildren, and a great-grandchild. Even her dogs. My goodness, if you were a dog in Betty's household, well, you had it made in the shade. But we would expect that from mom, wouldn't we? Proverbs chapter 12, verse 10, the righteous care for the needs of their animals. I found on her phone recently a picture when she, adopted or like her latest dog, Oliver. She was sitting on the floor and she had the dog's little face cupped in her hands, just like I could see her with the little kid at Spark. That's how she was. With all the things my mother did for her family and others, you might ask what John McKinnon asked me. Was your mother Martha, the one who was busying around the house to serve while Jesus was teaching? Or was she Mary, the one who was quietly sitting at Jesus' feet listening to what he had to say? Here's my answer. Mom was both. She knew how to serve and she did it well, but she also knew how to be quiet and still and worship. You know, the Apostle John says that he rejoiced to see the elect lady's children walking in the truth. But I can attest there's a corollary joy for children to see their parents walking in the truth and worshiping the one true living God and Jesus Christ, his Son. Over the years, from my earliest memories of being in this church to the time when my mother was stricken by strokes, I have the joys of memories of being with her in times of worship. Memories sitting by her side at the Christmas Eve services, singing the great carols, to memories of taking the bread and the wine of communion side by side with her. And there's one special memory that I treasure. It was one Sunday at Grace Bible Church. I happened to be in the pulpit like today, preaching. It didn't happen, it doesn't happen often, but it was that day. And my mother was there in the congregation. And we just caught eyes for the briefest of moments, and she smiled at me and I smiled at her. That was pure joy. By the way, you want to see that smile? That's my memory of that. Well, from that sanctified reflection, let's go back to the dogs. Mentioning my mom's dogs may seem trivial for the occasion, but it's not. From the smallest things in life to the biggest, from the least to the greatest, Mom went about doing good things, and everything seemed better when she was around. The significance of that is twofold. First, by all the good she did in life, in all the exceptional ways she loved others, she showed that she is the real deal, a true follower of Christ. Again, from the Apostle John, his first letter, chapter 3, verse 14, we know that we have passed from death to life because we love each other. 1 John chapter 4, verse 12, no one has seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. So true of my mother. Second significance, she has left us so many examples of what is good for us to imitate. And here I go from John's second letter to his third letter. As I said, it's a companion letter to 2 John. And the Apostle John wrote this in that third letter. Beloved, do not imitate evil, but imitate good. Whoever does good is from God. That's the key teaching of the entire 3 John. Immediately following that verse, John curiously mentions a character, a new character in that letter, Demetrius. He says, Demetrius has received a good testimony from everyone and from the truth itself. And what John has done there in his letter with Demetrius is to give us the type of person we want to imitate, someone of good testimony from everyone and of good testimony from the truth itself. Now, who does that sound like today? Indeed, Betty Bruce, universally of good testimony. Everyone I meet who knows Mom speaks so well of her. And the truth of God's word speaks well of her as well. Bears witness to her that she was good and worthy to be imitated. So I invite you now, maybe later today, over the Christmas holidays, ponder how you know her. Remember her ways. Meditate on what motivated her. And then resolve to follow in your life and in your way some example of the good you saw in her. But most importantly, follow her as she followed Christ. Well, I'll close with what comforted me most from John's letter in these past 6 months of my mother's life. It's found in verse 8 of 2 John. It's the full reward that was to be won by the chosen lady. What was that full reward that John spoke of? The reward that the chosen lady won, that my mother has also won, in a word, it's glory. Let's quickly think together with you about what glory means for the Christian. It means to be received into heaven, to be with Christ in the presence of his glory. On the night before Jesus was crucified, he was with his disciples, and he prayed for them, and he asked many things of the Father in heaven. But take special note of the part of the prayer as recorded by our Apostle John from John 17. He says, Jesus prayed, Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me may be with me where I am to see my glory that you have given me because you have loved me before the foundation of the world. And here is how the Apostle John described glory, or rather the vision he saw of it. You'll find this at the end of the revelation of Jesus to him. It's in the last chapter of the entire Bible. It says, the angel showed me the river of life as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and from the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood a tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month, and the leaves of the trees are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants, note this, his servants will be with him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. They will not need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever. Now that is some vision of glory. That's not all. The full reward includes something more, a crown. From 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8, it's this Apostle Paul's last recorded letter before his martyrdom. He says, henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, the day of his coming, and not only to me, but to all who have loved his appearing. And from James, the brother of Jesus, he said this, blessed is the one who remains steadfast under trials, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. And from the Apostle Peter, he says, when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. And so what do we say to all of this with respect to my mother and to this day on which we've gathered in celebration of her life and in witness to the resurrection? I go back to the wisdom of Solomon in Ecclesiastes, where we started this reflection. Here's what I say about my mother. A good name is better than precious ointment in the day of death and the day of birth. Well, we've reflected on my mother's life and love and service to Christ and to those around her, all the sacrifice and the good time and the hard times, and there were hard times and tears, we all know that there are, especially these past 6 months. She ended her days possessing that good name, which is far better than the most expensive ointment, and she left us remembrance of her faith and ways worthy of imitation so that we might gain for ourselves a good name like hers. The day of her death is surely better than the day of her birth because of the reward she has won in Christ, seeing his glory and winning for herself a crown of righteousness and glory. For all the trials and hardships of life, to live for Christ and die for Christ, it's worth it all. The full reward, it's worth it all. It'll be worth it all too for you and for me to follow her and to imitate her goodness, especially to imitate her faith in Christ and her aim in life to please him. And here's what I say about this day. Again, it's better to go to the house of mourning than the house of feasting, for death is the destiny of everyone, and the living take it to heart, and sorrow is better than laughter, for a sad face is good for the heart. We've reflected on my mother's life and death, and we can't help but think that we are mortal, and death awaits us too. The wise will take it to heart and prepare for that day now by fleeing in faith to Christ who has conquered death, so that no matter how we have lived up to this point, we might henceforth live for Christ and eternal life with him beyond the grave. If that is what we take away from this day, then though our faces show sadness appropriate for a funeral and for the departing of our loved one, Betty Bruce, then the day has been good for our hearts. For we are glad for her, and we are encouraged because of glory and reward that are hers and that can be ours too, if by faith alone, we are in Christ Jesus.
Let us pray. O God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants, who having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. Especially we thank you this hour for your servant Betty, whose baptism is now complete in death. We praise you for the gift of her life, for all in her that was good and kind and faithful, for the grace you gave her that kindled in her the love of your dear name and enabled her to serve you faithfully day by day. We thank you for her sense of art, of equity, of justice, for her dedication to those she cared about, for her trust in you, for her gratitude, for her forgiveness, for how she changed the future of so many children in our community. We thank you for God, for all the things you did with her life that reflected your presence in her life to the world around her. We thank you that for her death is past and the pains and trials of this world ended, and that she has now entered the joy you have prepared. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I ask you to rise in body or spirit, however you're comfortable, and join me in the affirmation of faith found printed in your bulletin. Friends, what do we believe? We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Betty Carol Bruce. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming, receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light.
to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, and now and forevermore. Amen.